You're listening to The Jets Factor on SoundCloud.com and the Grandstand Sports Network.
Third down snap. Sanchez to the end zone over Arrington. And touchdown, New York Centennial Homes.
Now, here's your host, CJ DeSimone.
What's going on, Jets Nation? Welcome to another edition of the Jets Factor podcast here on SoundCloud.com. I'm your host, CJ the Painkiller DeSimone. I have a very special guest joining me today. We're going to talk a little bit about free agency, as free agent week is upon us. It is finally upon us.
Shut the hell up.
No, it's actually upon us. It really is. So, you know, hopefully Mike Maccagnan has his
plan. I love it when a plan comes together.
You know, that's exactly what we love, brother. We love it when those plans come together. But first, let's pay some bills. The Jets Factor podcast on SoundCloud.com is sponsored by the following entities. By Big C's Barbershop. When you need an old school cut, Big C's is the place to go for all your grooming needs. Call 772 area code 663-4440 or search up Big C's Barbershop on Google Plus to book your appointment now. Big C's is the place to be. By thegruingtruth.net. The Jets Factor podcast is now accessible on thegruingtruth.net. For a wide array of sports coverage, thegruingtruth.net is your place to go. Gruingtruth.net, where legends speak. By www.nyjetfans.com, your number one source for everything New York Jets, including yours truly's podcast. For a limited time, tees are on sale at nyjetfanshop.com for only $10. Get them while supplies last. Again, www.nyjetfans.com. And, of course, don't forget, you can catch the Jets Factor podcast on the Grandstand Sports Network. Follow them on Twitter, at Grandstand_SN. Now, it gives me great pleasure to bring in our guest who's going to be joining us today. He most recently made an appearance on the Let's Talk Jets podcast. And I've got some very special music to bring him into, so let's get to this. Ladies and gentlemen, he is known as Jeff L. Lloyd on Twitter. Number one in your programs, number one in your hearts. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to bring on Jeff Lloyd, our hometown podcast draft analyst guru, and the closest thing we're going to get to Mel Kiper Jr. here in our podcast day. Jeff, how you doing today?
Could not be better, CJ. We're about, 40-something days away, so, picking it up a notch, you know, more coffee during the day, doing everything we can to survive these days.
Nice. Listen, first off, I want to thank you so much for taking the time out to join me today on the show. I know we were trying to get you on Friday, but I know we had some scheduling difficulties. So I appreciate you taking the time out to join us today. So first things first, let's get into it. Let's start talking a little bit about free agency. You know, obviously this is the week. Everybody's getting excited, and you know, we've got some big heavy names coming up. And of course, you know, every time we talk about free agency, the first thing that we talk about is the Jets, and we talk about the Jets going after the Kirk Cousins, you know, getting into the Kirk Cousins sweepstakes. As of today, right now at this current moment in time, special thanks to the Cleveland Browns, the Jets have the most cap space in the NFL going into free agency. Tell me, look into your crystal ball, other than Kirk Cousins, which is the obvious, who else do you see the Jets targeting?
It's going to be interesting. I think Trumaine Johnson, cornerback, is someone they're going to have to look to. They can go the route of paying him big money. Physical guy at the line. He fits the Bulls scheme. You can fall back if it doesn't work out. Obviously, they could bring back Claiborne, who they were comfortable with. I don't know if the haul is going to be so great during free agency for Jet fans that people, are hoping to. I think it's going to come down to, first and foremost, Kirk Cousins, which, I would say if you're going to put the odds, I'd say that they're maybe at a third. I think Minnesota is probably a strong first. I know Denver is trying to put, things into place with some of the recent moves they've been making to open up the spot for him. So that's what you're going to have to be looking for there. I think you're going to see some mid-tier guys, running back-wise. You know, Damian Thomas has already been mentioned from Miami, guys of that nature. The wide receiver class, it's interesting because what we don't know, would the Jets have a tremendous amount of interest in Allen Robinson? Yes, they could, but there's reasons for that we don't know. We don't understand where they are right now with Robbie Anderson. They love the player. Obviously, Robbie Anderson, the guy off the field, is not doing himself any favors. Quincy Enunwa, if you're promising you're getting a 100% Quincy Enunwa back, the 2016 form, then yeah. I mean, you probably like what you have at wide receiver. We don't know the answers to that. Any interest we hear on Allen Robinson is going to answer one of those two things. So if you hear a lot of interest in Allen Robinson, that maybe, you know, makes you a little nervous about the future of Quincy Enunwa and his health. Then you get to other wide receivers, whether it's a John Brown from Arizona, Paul Richardson from Seattle. These type of guys can come in and give you some of what Robbie Anderson does. These guys are straight vertical threats. They run the nine very well. They're successful with it. If you see interest in those guys, then you know the Jets are obviously concerned a little bit with Robbie Anderson. Any way you slice it, whatever's going on, Robbie Anderson's probably going to be missing somewhere along the lines next year, a month of football. So those are guys you got to look into. The pass rush, it's, again, pretty much non-existent. Coney Ealy only provided you with one sack last year, but there were a lot of pressures. There were a lot of batted balls. I think that's a guy you got to prioritize as far as defense is concerned.
Yeah, I totally agree, especially on the re-signing of Coney Ealy. He definitely does bring an element to the defense that does, also benefit Leonard Williams. And with the departure of Muhammad Wilkerson, even though they are going to retain Steve McClendon, I still think that either if Deion Simon can find a way back onto this playing squad from the practice squad, then it could definitely help out a little bit. I mean, Mike Pennell helped out in some situations, but he was hit or miss. There were times where Mike Pennell was kind of shooting the team in the foot with holding penalties and so on and so forth, or face mask penalties, just taking unnecessary penalties in bad spots, and then what else could be said about Muhammad Wilkerson's departure? I mean, that entire scenario is just a giant mess, and I'm just glad it's gone. But, nevertheless, there's still another position here. Some Jet fans have actually flirted with the possibility of the Jets reuniting with Sheldon Richardson. Now, me, for one, I'm totally against that. I don't want Sheldon back. I don't care what kind of a talent he is. The talent that he puts forth on the field is not worth the headache that you're going to have to deal with in the locker room and outside of the NFL arena. Now, this is, again, also where, unfortunately, Robbie Anderson falls into that category as well. He made some tweets going after Chris Carter. He's already getting himself into trouble with the arrest, being arrested two times. We don't know what type of discipline is going to be coming down. Could be a possibility. We may end up losing Robbie Anderson for 6 to 8 games. So there's some serious repercussions. So for them, I think the Jets would be smart in going after an Allen Robinson because of the great unknown of Robbie Anderson and his retardedness off of the field. And then, Quincy Enunwa coming back from injury, although it's nice to get Quincy back, you don't know exactly what kind of shape you're going to be getting Quincy in. And can he still be that player that he was before he got injured? So going after an Allen Robinson makes sense. But I want to turn my attention to the offensive line, because the offensive line has been the biggest Achilles heel besides the quarterback for this New York Jets squad, and has been so for the past couple of years. Now, I have my eyes on some tackles. I have my eyes on some guards and some centers that I definitely would like the Jets to take a look at. I'm going to throw a couple of names at you and see possibly what you think. The first one right on the top of my list, Cameron Fleming. Okay? Big body, great talent there. Another person, Chris Hubbard, in the tackle position. Moving on to centers, my first target right off the bat, Ryan Jensen, Baltimore Ravens. Go get him. He's a big body, solid center, a good centerpiece that you could actually anchor a good offensive line around. And I think Brian Winters will actually benefit from being able to play with somebody like Jensen. Another one I was looking at too was Weston Richburg, and believe it or not, here's a familiar. Here's another familiar name to the Jet faithful out there. Matt Slauson, he was a former Jet years ago, and he's out there on the market. So, your opinions on those names I just threw out there.
I think I would, you know, I have no problem bringing in Fleming. I'm not sure if right tackle is exactly the issue. I think you did point out well, though, on the center position. That needs to be addressed, whether it's Jensen, whether it's Richburg. I would lean Jensen's way. Richburg, you know, with the neck, I know the Giants kind of shut him down last year, and, you know, he claimed that he was healthy, but the Giants just basically, you know, said, look, no reason risking anything here, as bad as the season was going. But Jensen probably would be the key. And I think you're going to get better guard play if you get better center play. You know, those guys are suffering, you know, struggling, trying to, you know, basically, you know, man their assignments. And also keeping in mind that, you know, the Heat could be coming straight up the gap, you know, over the center every time. So he's intriguing names there as far as Jensen. Richburg is a player I really do like, but you got to wonder their medicals. And look, you don't want to take in, you don't want to, you know, take a shot on a guy when you know he's already got an injury history. It's such a huge position of need. So Jensen, I do agree with you. Jensen should be, you know, they should be camping outside that door. There should be no question about that.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I mean, because, you know, Jensen's one of the guys that I was actually looking at for a long, long time, believe it or not. You know, and they were even talking about the center from Washington who actually plays with Kirk Cousins. And, you know, that his name escapes me at the moment, but if the Jets were to go after him, could it possibly entice Kirk Cousins to sign with the Jets? I mean, right now, as it stands, the Jets are going to be able to offer Kirk Cousins the most money. But bringing Kirk Cousins in isn't necessarily a good fit for him, number one. And number two, with Minnesota being on the board and, you know, Arizona now starting to throw their hats in the ring, you always have the ever-present Denver and the John Elway mystique. He was able to lure Peyton Manning up there, so some people seem to think that may be, if he's not going to Minnesota, he's possibly going to Denver, because the only reason he would come to the Jets is because we would just basically hand him over the checkbook and say, well, sign whatever you want. But I'm not entirely sold on that theory. I think that if Mike Maccagnan is smart and if Chris Johnson is smart and you sell Kirk Cousins, the mystique of the New York Jets, and a lot of people, when you hear about the mystique of the New York Jets, it's bridled in nothing but laughter. But it couldn't be further from the truth. Okay, you've got a young, hungry, up-and-coming team who overachieved last year when we were picked to go 0-16, possibly 1-15, to accomplish 5-11. Okay, now that might not be a monumental accomplishment, and it may be, woohoo, let's cheer, we did 5-11. No, that's not the point. In a rebuilding year, when a team goes 5-11, that's something to look at with some sort of optimism that the arrow is pointing up. You know, I'm not saying let's go and throw a parade for the New York Jets down the Canyon of Heroes because they went 5-11 in a rebuilding year, but at least that you have some pieces in place and some players where the arrow is pointing up. So the Jets may not be as far off as people think. And you add a couple players here, a couple players there with the same mindset, plus have a really good draft in which the Jets now, before it was a solid lock in the draft, now it's not so much because of the Cleveland Browns doing the damage that they did yesterday. You know, with the Buffalo Bills acquiring picks, the Miami Dolphins acquiring picks. Now there's talk that Buffalo and Miami could possibly leapfrog the Jets and currently make deals with the Browns to give some of their picks back to possibly get that number four pick or to possibly get the first pick overall. Maybe they don't necessarily make a pick with them. Maybe they make a backroom deal with the Giants. Maybe they make a backroom deal with the Colts. Maybe they make a backroom deal with the Broncos at this point. You know, so any type of worst-case scenario, which at first we all thought were really crazy anomalies that we were just thinking of, you know, in like a terrified stupor, they're now starting to come to pass, believe it or not. These are legitimate scenarios that could possibly go down now. So, again, I'm going to ask you to look into your crystal ball. First, I'm going to give you a little bit of a two-parter here. First, on the whole Kirk Cousins circus, where do you see the Big Top finally landing? And then from there, how does that decision affect what the Jets do in the draft?
As far as I keep going back to Minnesota. Look, they have three quarterbacks there, and the money they're going to about to offer Kirk Cousins, it's going to make him feel – they're going to sell him on the, hey, we lost the NFC Championship game. We wouldn't have lost the NFC Championship game with you. Here's $28 million, and let's go do this. I think they're going to give the strongest sale pitch, and obviously they're coming from the best standpoint as far as, you know, who, you know, what they did last year as a team. You know, still got, you know, Dalvin Cook coming back from the injury, got the young receivers in place. Kyle Rudolph's a good tight end. Defense is really good. It seems the easiest one to slip into. But yes, now this is huge, is how is this going to affect the draft? Cleveland's going to take a quarterback at one. There's no way around that. They're going to take a quarterback at one. The Giants, now this is where it gets interesting. The New York Giants, by all means whatsoever, because of the way they carry themselves and, you know, the way they hold themselves as an organization, should be taking a quarterback at two. In their eyes, they're never going to pick two again for another 10, 15 years. So if you're at two, you take the quarterback. But in the same respect, they carry themselves with a stubbornness of a, it wasn't that bad last year. This had broken that way and this had broken that way. We would have been right in it. So, you know, you're hearing this talk of Saquon Barkley. Look, Saquon Barkley is a fantastic player. He's an electric running back. But you have no offensive line in New York. Your quarterback is 37. If you're not going to compete right away, if you don't have an offensive line, you're going to just waste the early years of Saquon Barkley. So now if the Giants are going to play this the smart way and what a team that is rebuilding, and whether or not they want to admit it, the Giants are rebuilding. You shouldn't be going out and trading two picks for a linebacker that makes $10 million a year. Huge mistake there. They should be trading out of two. They need to build an offensive line. They have holes. They need to get some defensive line in place because they're paying almost $90 million in guaranteed money to a defensive line that is not bringing back the return on that. Two of these guys, if not three, could be out by the 19 season. They need a lot, the Giants. So they should be looking to move out. So will that be a quarterback at two? Regardless of who makes the pick, it's quarterback at two. The Colts are interesting. Not going to take a quarterback. But if they could slip out a pick or two to, you know, to five or to six and maybe still end up with Bradley Chubb or Minka Fitzpatrick, those type of players, that's a smart move for them to make. Which leaves now, if you're the Jets, what are you looking at? Here are names you would be okay with. You'd be okay with Kirk Cousins. Well, that domino's fallen, didn't get that domino. Sam Darnold most likely is going to go to Cleveland at one overall. There's your second domino. You only got two left. If the Giants pick is in play, and if the Colts pick is in play, if the Broncos are in front of you, and obviously in this scenario, they did not get Kirk Cousins, you've got three spots. You've got two, three, five, and there's only two quarterbacks left in Baker Mayfield and Josh Rosen. You can't walk out of this without the quarterback. The whole point of the crappy season last year and getting yourself 5-11 and getting yourself at a number six pick again was to finally address the quarterback long term. But you could be on the outside looking in. It's not going to cost as much for the Jets as it's going to cost these other teams to move from 6 to 4 if it's Cleveland, if a quarterback gets there, to 3 to Indy. But if you're the Jets, look, there's four brides here. You cannot get yourself in a position where you don't get any of them.
Right. And I know that Jet fans are already starting to cringe with the idea that they may be left at 6 with Josh Allen. Although for me, if Josh Rosen should happen to fall to 6, he would be a name that I wouldn't mind the Jets being associated with. My odds-on favorite is Baker Mayfield. I've been screaming that you either take Baker Mayfield or Lamar Jackson with that 6th pick. Lamar Jackson, despite all of the talk that's coming out about that some teams wanted him to practice as a wide receiver instead of as a quarterback, there are some circles which are comparing Lamar Jackson to Deshaun Watson. You know, the Jets passed up Deshaun Watson last year in order to get Jamal Adams. So, sorry, my brain was a little bit slow to catch up. But you know, it's there are so many different factors in play where I think that the Jets need to have a short list of quarterbacks who they want to get in this draft. And I think that if plan A goes to hell, plan B goes to hell, plan C goes to hell, you need to have a contingency plan behind plan A, plan B, and plan C as to what you're going to do. If you're in love with a guy and you have to have him, to take words of my buddy Tyson Roush, I sell my soul to go and get him. If I have to go and I have to trade up in the draft to go and get a Josh Rosen, or if Sam Darnold doesn't go number one overall, if it ends up being somebody else, I'm all in to get him. Whatever the deal is, I'm on the phone making that phone call. What do you think at that scenario? Is that a gamble you could see Mike Maccagnan taking?
I don't think he's got a choice at this point. And this is where they got really lucky that Kirk Cousins actually was hitting the free agent market. And look, I think they're in it. I don't think they're going to win it. But the problem is, you know, he's not done a terrible job with his roster building. But if you look at one position, he's done a absolutely horrible job. And it's the quarterback position. They can't evaluate him, which led to the draft picks of Bryce Petty, which led to the draft picks of Christian Hackenberg. And they can't get anybody in the building to develop him. The fact that Christian Hackenberg was drafted where it was picked, you know, in the 50s, and we've gone two full NFL seasons without him taking an NFL snap, it's an embarrassment of a selection. It's so bad. It's just dumb. I mean, it's numb. It just makes you numb in the head how terrible the selection was. If you couldn't even get this guy out to play in a season where you had 2 years where you were drafting at six.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. But I have to ask you, in your opinion, is that a general manager's issue? Whereas, you know, is he going off of the evaluation of talent from his scouting department? Or is he making that decision based on whatever game tape or whatever film study that he's witnessed? Because when I've looked at the overall body of work of Bryce Petty, I don't know exactly why he was selected. The same thing with Christian Hackenberg. So I mean, if you know, I'll never forget that press conference when I sat and I listened to Mike Maccagnan go up in front of the media as some like smug little retard. Okay, and just act like he was holding a piece of gold in his hand in the term of Christian Hackenberg, and no one in the media was smart enough to see that it was gold. But really, it just sounded like that he had fool's gold in his hand, because you picked up a project football player, you knew it was going to take 2 to 3 years to develop. His development went sideways. I mean, the kid's got mechanical issues. He's got accuracy issues. It doesn't matter how strong his arm is. He could throw a ball over the Empire State Building. But if you can't hit the target on the other side, then what good is it? You know, so I mean, with Bryce Petty at times, you know, you want Petty to run a scout team. You want Petty to run a number two offense, a number three offense. He could run it to a T. But he can't run a number one NFL offense. He just can't. And it doesn't – again, he's the same problem. Another kid with a big arm who can get the ball 50, 60 yards down the field. But if he can't hit the target, what good is it? You know, so in your opinion, is this a structural issue in regards to the scouting department, or is just Mike Maccagnan just that much of an idiot when it comes to quarterbacks?
Well, the problem is you're looking at – the thing is you need to look at what a guy does. Too many times, guys, you look at a player and say, well, he doesn't do this, we can fix this. He doesn't do this, we can fix this. You got to make sure he can do what you need him to do, and his faults are not going to be great enough that it hurts you. So the issue there was, you know, with Bryce Petty, where you drafted him at the fourth round pick, you know, that type of selection, you're looking at it, is this guy going to be, you know, a number two quarterback for me? You want to know what? Bryce Petty fits that bill. The selection of Hackenberg was more of, we think we're a little bit smarter than everybody else here. We're going to take him here because we think we have ourselves a starting quarterback. You go two ways with it. Now, Hackenberg has not played a down in the NFL in 2 years. You look at a similar scenario. Cleveland drafted DeShone Kizer in the same spot last year, played him the entire season. a lot of bumps in the road, and now a new front office was brought in, and one of the first things they did was ship Deshaun Kizer out in a trade. So that's just, you know, it's the yin and the yang of it. Do I think he went out to Happy Valley, spent time with Christian Hackenberg, and fell in love with the person? Yeah, but falling in love with a guy is fantastic. Falling in love with the player is what you should be doing, and I think he kind of skewed himself there. Look, there's top quarterbacks available this year. They cannot evaluate them. They can't develop them. These guys are close to as ready can be. So to be on the outside looking out, this could possibly end up being Mac's downfall. He's got to walk out of this with either Kirk Cousins or either Darnold, Rosen, or Baker Mayfield. There's just no way around it.
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, because, you know, his job and even potentially Todd Bowles' job is on the line right now. And I really think that should the Jets screw up this draft and don't get a young quarterback in this draft with that number six pick, or if they trade up or whatever, it could really be doom. In my opinion, I think right after the draft, I'm going to be honest with you, if he doesn't get a quarterback with that number six pick, he should be out. You clean house. So you take the pieces in there, you bring somebody else in, and you let them fix it. I know it's not something that's really done in NFL lore, but it's like, you know, you went through all this trouble to stockpile all of these picks, and now the one thing that he cannot do is he cannot have a draft reminiscent of the Isaac 12, so to speak, where basically none of them panned out. You know?
Absolutely.
It's just mind-numbing at this point. So, overall, from your crystal ball again, best case scenario right now, let's try and end this on a positive note for all of Jets Nation. What do you see the Magic Mike doing at this point?
I think Baker Mayfield at the end of the day is going to be a New York Jet. Is going to be the New York Jet quarterback. I think they need it from the personality standpoint. He's going to come right in. And one thing I keep going back to is you go to that Thursday night game last year where you saw the young D all dancing in unison, a whole bunch of guys having fun. You need to find that flavor for the offense. And, I mean, Baker Mayfield is going to bring that flavor in spades. He's a guy, obviously, carries the chip on his shoulder. You know, always been, you know, viewed as the small dog in the room everywhere he's gone his entire life. That's not going to change. So the fieriness and the competitive and the, you know, the jawing that he's going to do, it's not going to stop. I mean, he's been beaten down for so long and pushed down for so long. He's always going to feel that way. And look, this franchise kind of needs that on the offensive side of the ball. So Baker Mayfield has to be the target. I think Darnold's going to go too early. I don't see the dots connecting for Rosen, but I do see, at the end of the day, Baker Mayfield carrying on the tradition at the quarterback position for this New York Jet franchise.
Nice. Now, I do have an interesting scenario that I want to throw out, and this was something that I kind of flirted with, only because when it comes to the quarterback position, I'm incredibly greedy. Okay, should the Jets be able to land Kirk Cousins by some miracle of God? Okay, at the number six pick, my personal opinion, again, solely me, I still would go after a young quarterback at six, and I'll explain to you why. Because you sign Kirk Cousins to a five-year deal, however much money that may be, you surround him with some more weapons, you fix that offensive line, you retool the defense through the draft and through free agency as much as you can. And then you have that backup. You bring this young kid in as a backup quarterback to sit behind Kirk Cousins, learn the right way, be able to develop in Jeremy Bates' system from the ground up. And you have the New York Jets quarterback position sewn up for possibly the next 10 years where quarterback will not be an issue or somewhat not be an issue. What are your thoughts on that?
I mean, I can kind of understand where you're going from, but if you want to double up at quarterback, I mean, there's plenty of other options. You know, there's Mason Rudolph later. There's Lualeta later. There's Mike White out of Western Kentucky later. If you were able to get Kirk Cousins to commit and you're still going to have the number six pick in the draft, and you can go huge impact guy, whether it's a Quentin Nelson, whether it's a Bradley Chubb, or you trade down, or even cornerback. If you want to go top cornerback in the draft, whether it's a Denzel Ward, a Jaire Alexander, if you want to move back from six a little, address one of those issues, it's just too much at the position. And, you don't want to be paying a guy who was number six pick, overall pick in the draft, to be sitting around for 3-4 years, or a worst-case scenario, Kirk gets hurt and we're going to play. You can find backup quarterbacks later. And a lot of times, your better backup quarterbacks are guys who are found later. I think you draft a quarterback at six, if you have Kirk Cousins in the building, it's going to do more damage than good, because, number one, are you going to get the work ethic out of the kid that you drafted number six, knowing that there's no playing time to be had anytime soon? It's a lot different when it's a guy who knew he was drafted in the mid-rounds, later rounds, and knew what he was drafted for his job to be.
Hey, you know what? That's actually a very sound theory, and it does make a lot of sense. That wouldn't disappoint me at all if the Jets were to land Kirk Cousins and they do either, address another position of need. I just don't want to see them take best player available again and just end up taking somebody where, it throws the whole development process off of the rails. I want to see some positions of need on this team addressed within the draft, which was something that we saw a little bit of last year, and we actually had a couple of impact players in Jamal Adams and Marcus May. But again, on the back end of the draft, Dylan Donahue produced a little bit until he got hurt. And then, you had the two quarterbacks that they took in the later rounds, Robbie Anderson, undrafted free agent. So there are still impact players to be had in the later rounds, but I want to see guys I don't want to see middle-of-the-road guys. I want to see guys that can step in right away and assume that starting role and can actually go out there and produce on week one, because I think it's something that the Jets need right now to continue this rebuilding process. So, again, that's just my opinion. Real quick, any other positions of need that you would like to see addressed? I mean, we've beat this with a stick beyond glue. So, where else do you see the Jets going besides the obvious?
Well, I mean, pass rusher absolutely needs to be addressed. You have eight selections. One of them absolutely has to be a pass rusher. Running back position. I don't think you're going to get anything out of free agency that's going to change your thoughts. This is another deep class. McGuire, they drafted him last year. He had a nice little role. The question is, can he handle a bigger role? Bilal Powell, Bilal is what he is, and there's weeks where he's a really good running back. But it's time where you need more of the guy. And there were reasons Forte was getting all the carries he was getting last year. They didn't have enough confidence in the other guys, whether it's a Sony Michel, a Nick Chubb, guys like that. You need one of those guys who's capable to give you a 20-carry week, and you don't have the confidence in Powell, and you don't have the confidence – well, not that you don't have the confidence, but you've not seen it with McGuire. So you need a – I don't want to say a true number one, because nobody really runs a true number one running back, but you need the guy on the weeks where, you got up early, or you need to keep the game close, and the best way to do it is to run the ball and slow the game down. You're going to need one of those guys. For me, I think Nick Chubb with the Jets actually is a really, really nice – is a nice connection.
Really? What makes you think that he would be a good fit within the system?
He's an assignment runner. He will run to his hole. He doesn't freelance. Works well between the tackles. Has some thump, some power, when he gets to the linebacker level, whether or not he can break a tackle there. You're not going to get a lot of wiggle. He's got more speed than he's got wiggle. He's not ultra-really elusive. But he's, if you want to use the term, he's a Novocaine back. He's going to keep going, keep going, keep going. And the next thing you know, if he gets his 22, 23 carries, he's going to be north of 95 yards. It's just he's a perfect, chain-moving type of running back. And I think that's something the Jets got to add to this offensive mix.
Nice. Do you possibly see them going after maybe a power back for short yardage situations? I could definitely tell you that the Jets definitely miss the presence of Chris Ivory. Just a big, bruising, pounding back that could just beat up on defenses at will. Is there a possibility that there's a name out there that the Jets might be flirting around with?
I'm not sure if it's a way they're going to go, but if you're looking for that type of guy, you're looking at Bo Scarborough out of Alabama. Just a, you know, he's just a massive, massive guy. About 6'2", you know, actually slimmed down for the combine, was right around 230. But I mean, muscles everywhere. He's a beast to bring down. He would be, you know, that fourth quarter, 4 minute running back type of guy, and you know, should be able to, you know, help you out in goal line because he brings a lot of power.
Wow, that would actually be somebody I would not mind seeing in green and white. Bo Scarborough has definitely tore off a couple of runs over there, especially just pounding through defenses when they had him dead to rights. So, yeah, that's a great choice. That does make me a little bit excited there, Jeff. All right. So we're going to end today's show on that, but first off, as always, for you. Jeff, before we let you go, please give out all of your information, how our listeners can get in touch with you, give you a follow, interact with you on Twitter and stuff. Have at it. The floor is yours.
Okay. Obviously, guys, you know, at the Twitter account, at Jeff underscore LJ underscore Lloyd, always on there. I'm working with Daily Mock Draft. A buddy of mine about 2 years ago just started doing, through FanSpeak, a Browns mock draft every day. It picked up momentum. So now we took it to the point where, you know, there's one for every team. So, you know, we go through the FanSpeak app. I put one up every day, you know, so you get to see player names. You know, they're never the same, always, you know, vary because, you know, the site uses a bunch of different big boards. But it's just a fun thing. And for, you know, look, a lot of people, you know, you only maybe know the top 20 names in the draft. Or you maybe only know, you know, the guys who are coming out of the college that you attended. This is a way just to introduce more players, more prospects, so everybody kind of gets a better feel of it. So, you know, we definitely can see that there. You know, at Daily Mock Draft, I cover the Jets there. It's a great thing. It's a fun thing. You know, something you whip up every morning. It's kind of easy. But, you know, fans get to learn, you know, 6, 7, 8 different names every day. So it's getting a lot of positive feedback.
All righty. Well, thank you so much again for taking time out today to join us talking a little NFL free agency and the NFL draft. We will definitely be looking for you on Twitter and look very much forward to your reports during the course of the week as the free agent frenzy begins or Pandora's box opens this week.
Which, probably a better way to put it.
It's actually the best way to put it. You're right. So for CJ the Pitten Killer DeSimone and Jeff Lloyd, this has been the Jets Factor Podcast on SoundCloud.com. I'd like to thank everyone for taking the time out to download us. Be sure to follow the show at CNC Jets Factor. Follow me on Twitter at JetsFan0523. You can shoot the show an email, thejetsfactor@gmail.com. Don't forget to check us out on nyjetfans.com, thegruelingtruth.net, and the Grandstand Sports Network. We will see you guys when we see you guys.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.